Hey everyone, this is the final video on the SHTC3 sensor. In the first video, we identified the I2C temperature and humidity sensor and its data sheet. In the second video, we added the SHTC3 sensor to the Unitemp application. And in this video, we're going to look at the amount of delay needed after the wakeup command, and then we'll look at the clock stretching feature. All right, let's get started. I'm using a Dolphin board, which has multiple I2C inputs. The bottom row is ground, voltage, clock, and data. So I've hooked up the clock wire, is this brown wire, and it's going over into my logic analyzer on the brown line. And then for the data, I'm using the yellow wire, and that's going into the logic analyzer on the yellow wire. And then at the top, I've also hooked up the ground line to ground on the logic analyzer. In this first example, we look at what happens when we only delay 10 microseconds after the wakeup command. Let's take a look at the code now. Our code writes the wakeup command, then it sleeps for 10 microseconds, then it sends a measurement command asking for humidity and temperature. It sleeps 13 milliseconds to ensure the measurement's been taken. Next, we read 6 bytes of data from the sensor, which is the humidity plus the CRC and the temperature plus the CRC. And then we send the sleep command. Now we'll increase the delay to 40 microseconds. Control Shift B, launch app on Flipper. And then we'll open QFlipper. And with the extra delay, you can see we're now reading the proper temperature and humidity values. In the diagram, you can see that it says wake up time, see table 5. But table 5 only lists power up, soft reset, and measurement. It doesn't list wake up time. My guess is we should probably use 180, 240 microseconds as the wake up time as well. But I'm not really sure. Next, we'll use a logic analyzer to look at the data when things are working. So this is capturing the clock and data lines where we have that 40 microsecond sleep statement. Next, we'll zoom into one of these calls and see what the data looks like. So the top line is the clock, and the bottom line is the data. We did a write to address 70 for 3517, which is the wake up command. Then there was 110 microseconds of delay. This is probably the 40 microseconds plus overhead. And then we wrote to address 70, 58E0. Then zooming out, you can see that there was a 13 millisecond delay. And then we'll zoom in on this side. And you can see we did a read at address 70 and got back our 6 bytes of data. I switched the code back to 10 microseconds. You can see the temperature and humidity is incorrect. We're going to go ahead and capture that data. Then we'll zoom out and zoom into the beginning of the signal. We sent the 3517 wakeup command. Then we waited 80 microseconds. Then we tried to send 58E0. But after the 58, we did not get an acknowledgement. We had a NACK. This means our sensor never got the request to read the temperature data. Our code then waited 13 milliseconds. And then we read 6 bytes of data, which you can see is the device ID 08875B. And then we read FFFFFF. So when we did the write array with data humidity temp, it must have returned true. The true came from FruiHal I2CTX, which says returns true on successful transfer, false otherwise. Unfortunately, the code actually returns true as long as it didn't time out. So it's possible that you haven't transmitted everything. Line 90 size could be bigger than 0. And it's possible that not all the payloads were ACK'd. So it appears the current library doesn't allow us to determine if our transmits were acknowledged or not acknowledged. So that's a good lesson to learn. I'm going to go ahead and update that delay to 240 microseconds, which is the max time for power up and soft reset. Hopefully that's also a max time for wake up. So the second topic I wanted to cover in this video was clock stretching. I've copied our update method and named it underscore clock stretch at the end. And instead of sending 58E0 for reading humidity first, we're gonna send 5C24, which is the clock stretching version. After we request a measurement, we can just read the answer right away. We don't have to wait the 13 milliseconds, and the clock line will be stretched by pulling that line low until the data is ready. So let's go ahead and comment out that delay. Unfortunately, read array times out after 10 ticks, so we need to make a copy of that method in our code. We'll copy the method and rename it I2C read array clock stretch. We'll then add a timeout in milliseconds as a final parameter. We'll convert that into ticks, and then we'll change the hard-coded 10 to use those ticks. Then we'll update our code to use read array clock stretch, and we'll change our timeout to be 20 milliseconds, because we know about 13 is probably the maximum that we need. Modify the updater parameter to use clock stretch. Over in our header file, we'll add the update clock stretch method. So copy update and add underscore clock stretch. Control Shift B, launch app on Flipper. The clock stretch is working, so we'll bring up our logic analyzer. We'll go ahead and capture some data. And then we'll go ahead and zoom out and zoom back in to try to look at that data. So you can see we sent 3517 wakeup, and then we sent 5C24 clock stretching measurement, and then we immediately sent a read. And you can see that clock line is just pulled low right after that read. And then 10.6 milliseconds later, it resumed. And we'll zoom into that data, and you can see we got back the 6 bytes of data. And then we sent the sleep command. So to summarize, in this video, we learned that we need to have a delay after that wakeup command, and we decided 240 microseconds is probably a good amount of wakeup delay. And if you don't have those delays, we saw you could get wildly inaccurate data that would even CRC validate in some cases. We also looked at clock stretching, which enables us to read without having to have a fixed delay. However, we have to make sure that our read commands don't time out. And then we also learned that our Fruity Hal I2C calls may return true even when the data wasn't fully sent or where the data wasn't acknowledged by the device. So hopefully this video helped explain some of those advanced scenarios and some of the issues you may run into. Please like and subscribe, and if you have any questions or comments, please leave them below.